नमस्कार, आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर माई फर्स्ट लेक्चर ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडियन हिस्ट्री। हियर आई विल डिस्कस द सिलेबस ऑफ UPSC विच विल बी यूजफुल फॉर अदर स्टेट पब्लिक सर्विस कमीशन एग्जामिनेशन एंड एनी अदर एग्जामिनेशन, बिकॉज मॉडर्न हिस्ट्री इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ द सिलेबस ऑफ इंडियन हिस्ट्री एंड it is the part of the syllabus from most of the questions are being asked. It is either it is prelims or mains. Major chunk of the questions are from this portion only. We need to understand the various topics and the part of the syllabus. Even we have to remember the syllabus so that we can make our strategy according to that, because all the topics are not that much important in terms of our examination, and we need to prepare with a proper strategy. Modern Indian history starts with the decline of Mughal Empire, the mighty Mughals who ruled India for many generations. The founder was the Babur, and afterwards a series of great emperors are there: Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shahjahan, and Aurangzeb. They were the greatest emperors of Indian history who ruled for longer period and given a very stable government even till Shahjahan. The period of Aurangzeb is not considered as very glorious because of his intolerance, religious policies, and his eagerness to conquer the Deccan territory of India. That is the most difficult territory to conquer because it is a hilly terrain, and the people of Deccan and Rajputana are not ready to follow the policies of Aurangzeb. It takes him around 25 years, and the 25 years of long duration of warfare taken a big bite from the Mughal treasury as well. The economic condition deteriorated, and the Badshah or the successors of Aurangzeb had to face a lot of issues which we need to understand. The successor of Aurangzeb was Bahadur Shah I, Bahadur Shah Pratham. He became Mughal emperor at the age of 62 and few other places. But the situation after the death of Aurangzeb was completely changed. Most of the warrior communities like Sikhs, Rajputs, Marathas are not the support pillars of Mughals, but they are revolting against the hegemony of Mughals. There was no Sulh-e-Kul policy during the reign of Aurangzeb, and he tried to convert India from Darul Harb to Darul Islam, meaning by he tried to make all the people of India into the faith of Islam. He tried to convert majority of the population, and because of that, majority and especially those who are war torn, who considered themselves blessed when they die in the battlefield, are against the Mughals. Bahadur Shah I became the emperor or the successor of Aurangzeb after defeating two of his brothers, Kam Baksh and Muhammad Azam. and before becoming the Mughal emperor, his actual name was Muhammad Muazzam. He defeated his brothers in the battlefield and became the emperor. There were so many issues were there when he became the new emperor, like he has to reconcile with Rajputs, and he did that very well. He had to reconcile, or he had to make peace with Sikhs, because Sikhs under the leadership of Dashmi Padshahi Guru Gobind Singh Ji never accepted the tyrannical rule of Aurangzeb. He sacrificed four of his sons in his war against Mughals. And Bahadur Shah knew it very well. Even in a very interesting instance, when he was sent in his earlier days, when he was a prince, when he was sent to arrest Guru Gobind Singh Ji, he refused to that. He refused to arrest Guru Gobind Singh Ji because he respected him very well, very much. Because of the respect, he refused to arrest the Dasmi Padshahi. And when he became the new Badshah, made a peace treaty with him and given him a very high mansab. Mansabdari system started by Akbar based on two things: Jat, the ranking, and Sawar, the horseman, the particular officer had to manage. Jat was the ranking, and Guru Gobind Singh Ji was offered a very high ranking, 7000 Jat and 7000 Sawar. And to maintain his rank and to maintain the horseman, they were also given a part of land. And the revenue of the land was basically need to be used for his salary and the expenses of horseman. And that particular land is known as Jagir. And here comes the Jagirdari system. Mansabdari or Jagirdari, basically they are the same thing. It given high mansab to Guru Gobind Singh Ji, but when Guru Gobind Singh Ji accompanied him for his Deccan campaign, he was assassinated by a Pathan, and afterwards the relationship was not the same. His disciple, the disciple of Guru Gobind Singh Ji, and his close associate Banda Singh Bahadur considered it as a conspiracy to kill Guru Gobind Singh Ji and revolted against the mighty Mughals. The relationship did not continued cordial, and Bahadur Shah started the suppressive policies against Banda Singh Bahadur and even captured his one of the famous fort Lohgarh, but did not able to suppress them completely. His next target is Rajputana. He tried to make friendly relations with Rajputs like the king of Jodhpur, Amber, and even with the king of Jats Chhatrasal, who also helped him in his campaign against Banda Singh Bahadur. Bahadur Shah's reign from 707 to 12 was a period when he tried his best, but because of his incapability to understand the situation, he was not able to manage the situation very efficiently. Even if we talk about the Marathas, then a new situation created there. He released Sahu and his mother from the Mughals' captivity. They were the captives of Mughal Empire from the time when Sambhaji was captured and killed by Aurangzeb. Initially, he wanted to convert them into Islam, but he was advised by his ministers to not convert them, as after the conversion, they cannot use them against the Marathas to create a civil war there. But Bahadur Shah released them in 1708 without declaring him the new Maratha Chhatrapati. And a new civil war started there in Maratha as expected. We'll discuss it in detail in my coming lectures. Actually, Tarabai, the wife of Raja Ram, appointed his son Shivaji II as the new emperor of Maratha Confederacy. And when Sahu was released, a tussle was started between Tarabai and Shahu. And how Shahu became the new emperor with the help of a new appointed Brahmin, Balaji Vishwanath, and the Peshwa system, we need to discuss it later on. And after the death of Bahadur Shah, a series of incapable, incompetent rulers ruled India, Mughal Kingdom. The next is Jahandar Shah. He ruled for 1 year, but from Jahandar Shah to Bahadur Shah Zafar, even Bahadur Shah Zafar was definitely a very incapable ruler, but from Jahandar Shah onwards, the process of court conspiracies started, and every group of nobles means there are so many, or so you can say so many groups of nobles were there in the Mughal court, like Uzbeki group, Turani group, Turkis, Afghani group, Indian Muslim groups were there, and they all tried to appoint their own rulers, because there are so many contenders for the throne of Mughal Emperor. And from Jahandar Shah onwards, you can see that all the Mughal rulers became the puppet in the hands of their nobles, or the group of nobles, under the leadership of either Zulfikar Khan or Sayyid Brothers or Nizamuddin Asaf Zah. They all became the puppet, and the actual disintegration and decline started from here. Jahandar Shah was appointed by the leader of Irani group, Zulfikar Khan, crowned two young princes, Rafiuddaraz, Rafiuddaula, but they both died in a very short period of time. In the year 1719, Sayyid Brothers appointed the new ruler, and who was the last hope of Mughal dynasty, Muhammad Shah, 1719 to 1748, a long tenure. But he was not the man of the hour. He was not having any kind of capability. He was not having any types of efficiency to manage the affairs. He was called Rangila because of his indulgent nature. He was only concerned to enjoy the luxuries. He was only concerned in Geet Sangeet, dance. And during his reign, द ग्रेटेस्ट अटैक ऑफ नादिर शाह टूक प्लेस इन इंडिया. द इन्वेजन ऑफ नादिर शाह वॉज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट डिवेस्टेटेड अटैक इन इंडिया एंड देर वॉज सम इंटरनल कॉन्स्पिरेसी ऑल्सो देयर बिकॉज ही वॉज नॉट प्लान टू अटैक दिल्ली बट ही वॉज इंस्टिगेटेड टू अटैक दिल्ली. आफ्टर मोहम्मद शाह अ सीरीज ऑफ अदर रूलर्स केम इन टू एग्जिस्टेंस बट द ओनली इंपॉर्टेंट रूलर वॉज शाह आलम टू. He was not important because he tried to regain the authority. He tried to, you can say, establish the Mughals' authority over India. But he was important because he fought Battle of Buxar against Britishers. He signed a treaty of Allahabad with Britishers and became a pensioner of Mahadji Shindia, the ruler of Gwalior. Because in actual sense, Delhi was conquered by Sindhias. And ultimately, in 1803, Britishers captured Delhi. We all know that. After Shah Alam II, few more rulers came into the throne. But no one was in a position to gain any strength. To reorganize the Mughal authority, and it declined afterwards. The last ruler was Bahadur Shah Zafar. He was a part of the revolt of 1857. Two of his sons were killed in the front of Khuni Darwaja Lal Qila, and he was deported to Rangoon. And that was the end of Mughal Empire in India. Even before his death, Karjan and Dalhousie also declared that they are not going to become the rulers and they are not going to stay in Lal Qila. The next topic is rise of provincial powers in India. After the decline, when the decline of Mughal started, so many tiny powers tried to gain their authority. The provinces under the Mughal rule became independent or semi-independent. There were three types of provinces. The first one was earlier ruled by the governors or the officers of Mughals. In the second category was the group of rebellious states. You can call them those who did not accepted the Mughal authority, especially after Aurangzeb, even during the period of his reign. The Marathas, the Sikhs, the Rajputs, and the third category belongs to the part of India where Mughals did not able to establish their rule, like southeast, southwest, northeast part of India. We need to understand the first two categories because these are the provinces and their rulers who are going to make the future of India. They are the authority now. We have understood while discussing the period of Shah Alam II that the Mughals were not the actual rulers of India. Their place is being taken by the new powers. The Marathas, the Sikhs, the Rajputs. In this category, we'll discuss the provinces of the first category of provinces like Bengal, Awadh, Hyderabad, Bengal, Murshid Quli Khan, Awadh, Shadat Khan, Burhanul Mulk, Hyderabad, Nizamul Mulk, Asaf Zah, started Asaf Zahi dynasty. Second category, Maratha. These all are important because in prelims, you can expect few questions from all these parts. The Jarsan reasoning, true, false, maybe. The next topic is the coming of European power. Definitely, you all know that the first power which came to India was the Portuguese. They reached, the Vasco da Gama reached India in 1498. But why they came in 15th century only? Why not earlier? Why not afterwards? What is the reason behind it? The reason is same which was there for Renaissance. 1451, conquest of Constantinople by the Turks. Constantinople, the capital of Asia Minor. Asia Minor, the Eastern Roman Samraj, Eastern Roman Empire. And Eastern Romans are known for their trade and commerce, not for their victories. The capital was conquered by the Turks and Constantinople became Istanbul. And when they conquered Turkey, which was a kind of bridge between Asia and Europe, the land trade became really difficult. Then the search for the sea route started, which was spearheaded by Prince Henry, or the Navigator Prince. And Diaz discovered Cape of Good Hope, and following his footstep, Vasco da Gama reached Cape of Good Hope, the last tip of Africa, and from there, with the help of an Indian sailor, he reached Indian Calicut port. After Portuguese, Britishers came into existence, the East India Company, when the British Navy captured a ship from the sea pirates, and that ship belongs to the Portuguese traders, and from there they got to know about the way to reach India, the sea route, the details of their trade, the profits they make. And it was announced by the Queen that whosoever is going to start trade with India, they'll get some extra benefits like monopoly. And the merchant adventurers accepted the challenge and founded East India Company. They reached here, and the first officer who reached here was definitely Hawkins, which you all know that. And Sir Thomas Rowe was the person who got the permission from the Mughal Emperor to establish various factories in the various places of India. The story did not end it here. The story actually starts from here. The situation was a kind of invitation for the foreigners. The situation of India, the political instability, lack of central authority, given basically a kind of invitation to the far-sighted governor of French East India Company, Dupleix. Initially, it was not Britishers who tried to gain the political authority in India, or tried to use Indians against Indians. He was Dupleix. And because of his ambition and because of some international affairs, the Battle of Karnataka took place, which is also known as Anglo-French Struggle, 1746 to 63. That changes the destiny of India. You may be thinking that what happened to Portuguese and the Dutch, who follows the Portuguese trade pattern to trade in India. They both were not interested to do trade with India, and as Indian traders were not very much honest in their business, they used to mix their inferior spices with the good quality of spices from Southeast Asia, and they sell it in a very high price. So they decided to go to the Southeast Asia, and they only came to India for their business of cotton and handicrafts. You may say the trade of cotton and handicrafts. After the end of Karnataka War, Britishers became the only power, the foreign power, or the contender of Indian political authority. There was only one authority that can challenge them, that was Marathas. But third battle of Panipat with Ahmad Shah Abdali changed the destiny, and Marathas now confined themselves to Maharashtra only. This is the first part of our syllabus. I'll discuss the second part, which includes the British conquest of India. Next topic will be constitutional development under Britishers, revolt of peasants and tribals, and the second and the last topic would be the revolt of 1857. That would be the second phase. And afterwards, we'll discuss the socio-cultural reform movement. Let me tell you one thing very clearly, that this is a brief discussion. I'll take all the topics in greater detail also, so don't worry. I'm just trying to give you a glimpse of Indian history and the syllabus, so that you can understand the various topics in a good manner and remember it when you hear it like a story. I'm trying to do the same thing. So I'll discuss the second part of the syllabus of modern history in my next lecture. Till then, please follow the government instructions. The situation is very critical. Now we are going to reach a 30,000 mark. This is not a small issue. Please be at your home only and don't go out. Avoid to go out even. Take care of yourself and take care of your family. All the best. Namaskar.